Good evening. So first of all, I want to congratulate Ashish for this fantastic event. So yeah, round of applause for him, please. I don't know where he is, but great work. Second, I just wanted to check, the energy in this room seems a little low. So are there a lot of VCs here, or what happened? How many people here are VCs? All right, that's okay. We can handle two people. Okay, so you know what I wanted to talk about today was give everybody a sense on you know, our learnings. We've been doing InMobi. I'm the founder and CEO of it. We've been doing InMobi for past 3.5 years. We've been working on it, and we've gone through a number of different phases of growth. Some exciting, some less so. A lot of mistakes, and a lot of things that we have learned, and I thought I'll try and share some of that with you over the next 30 minutes. And then I would love to open it up for questions so that if you have, I'd be more than happy to answer them. So let me also try and give everybody a sense of what is InMobi, like what do we do? Because you know, that's just important to understand from our business model point of view as before we get into the specifics of it. So, you know, as InMobi, we are at the center of mobile advertising. So we are the center of mobile ecosystem. And the reason we are at the center of this mobile ecosystem is because we work with two entities. On one side, we work with advertisers, as you can see on your left side of your screen. On the right side, we work with publishers. Now, on the left side, we work with advertisers who are essentially looking for users. They have a lot of money. On the right side, we're working with publishers who have great content, have users, but have no money, and they're looking for money. So there's a great, you know, and we can just come in between and kind of match the two and, you know, make our money. So we have brokers. And I know it's not a great term to use, to be broker, but I love it because it's transaction. And we just take money out of the transaction every second. So it's a beautiful business to be at the center of all of this. Just to give you some sense on like what kind of things happen on this. So for example, on this specific, okay, so that's hard to see. But on a specific phone, you basically will have, you know, different kind of ads that appear, and you know, they can have different purposes. So you can have an ad which is this of a Reebok, which can have a download attached to it, of that of a Yamaha, which will have a video attached to it, you know, of Pizza Hut, which is a coupon. So there are tons of different purposes that exist that are attached to the ad that's up there. All right, so now let me try and get into the story of InMobi. And the way I kind of tried to do this was to break up the story of InMobi into 5 different phases in order to understand it better. And the 5 different phases are as following. There was a phase of pre-2007. The pre-2007 phase was, you know, when there was nothing and, you know, we were just a bunch of people roaming around and trying to figure something out. 2007, the phase two is, you know, between early 2007 and mid of 2008, our first phase of trying to do something in the form of InMobi. The second is for about another 10, 12 months, which is the phase three and phase four. So I'll talk about each one of these phases. There are specific learnings that we have from each of these phases, specifics around how we have tried to execute, things that we did right and things that we didn't do right. So the phase one, you know, the phase one was all about trying to just keep going, right? You know, you just had to do something. It lasted for me personally, it lasted for about 18 months. And it was 18 months of wandering around, right? It was just trying to do something which hopefully made sense to people in general and as customers or to people with money. Those are the two things that I was just trying to figure out. And you know, it's a phase where you have to go through a number of different quick experimentations, and figure out if something's gonna work out or not. When you start something in this specific phase, you're actually very sure about a lot of things. You're sure about how it's gonna work, how it's gonna function, but actually none of that works. And that's the beauty of it, because you're so close to things and you're so excited. You're like, you know, I was 27 and 28 when I was going through this phase. I just thought everything that I was going to put my hand on, it was just, you know, it was just going to be $1 billion. Was I wrong, or was I just absolutely, you know, I can't use those words, but, you know, I was just absurdly wrong there. And you really need to, you know, kind of speak to a lot of people to figure out that things are not going to work out. I wrote a number of business plans. They're all in the trash today. None of them made any sense. So, you know, kind of talks about how many business plans you end up writing and, you know, and how they're not necessarily going to work. But what you also actually kind of get, which is, you know, which people kind of undermine a little bit, is you try and start to understand why things are not working, why something did not work. And I don't think people really value failures within themselves because they're going through it at that point of time. So because you don't value the failure at that point of time, you actually don't know how fantastic that failure is in the long run for you. So what was happening to us, and you know, I kind of look at this in retrospect, is I learned to fail, and I learned why I failed. And so I had this enormous amount of information that I was keeping with myself on, you know, how to fail, so I could avoid that in future. I think this specific period is the toughest. It's like you're going through a degree of entrepreneurship. And again, while you're going through this, the emotions are very different. You're going through a very different mental state. You know, your mental state is very different. Your parents are basically coming up at you and saying, what the hell are you doing? Where are you going to get the next month's salary from? You actually have no money. Your lifestyle has suddenly plummeted. You're living in an apartment with a view, and suddenly you're living in an apartment with a bunch of people without a view and without anything. For us, we were living in an apartment in Bombay, three of us, and we had all that we had were three mattresses, an internet line, and our laptops. Yes, we had a fan also. And that was useful because, you know, the fan was good because it was Bombay. And in the morning, we would get up at 9 a.m. very, very, you know, we were very diligent about this, that we got to be on time. We got to go out of office on time at 9 a.m. So we would sit up, roll up our beds, and sit on it because that was our office. And that feeling, you know, today was great because, you know, it's like fairy tale, but at that point of time, it's a tough phase to go through. And so you basically want people with you at that point of time who can actually, you know, help you keep on going. And that's what you want. You want to go on. I think the worst mistake that you can make is to quit at this stage, because the fact that you can just stay there during that phase is 80% of the success, or even higher. Beyond it, it's whether it'll be huge or, you know, not so huge, but who cares about that? Let it become a success. I think that's critical. So stay on is what I learned from that. At the end of this phase, here's what we did. We got few people to put in about $500,000. We had a team of four passionate people, absolutely berserk. In terms of, I think we were all four crazy people because, you know, nobody would actually go and do this, what we were trying to do. Raise $500,000 and quit our jobs and kind of move back to India and, you know, sit in, you know, kind of sleep in one room all together and work in a 500 square foot office where, you know, if any one of you tried to get to, you couldn't. We had issues trying to get to there at different times of the season. But I think there was this youthful excitement, which is the key, which was clubbed with this business plan, which was actually dwindling, which had like no legs, period. It had all the ingredients to fail, full stop. But somebody agreed to put money on it. That's all that mattered. We took the money. Before the money even hit our account, we changed the business model. We knew this was not going to work. And the whole point, we went to our venture capitalists, our angel investors, and said, this is not going to work. You are crazy. You put money on crazy stuff. I have a better idea for you. And they looked at us with aghast and said, but the money just hit your account 2 days ago. I said, that's the reason why I'm coming 2 days later. Because we can now do this right. I couldn't have come to you like 2 days ago, you know, 5 days ahead of time and said that I'm changing the business plan. You wouldn't have put the money in. Trust me on this. Well, did they have any other option? Probably not. So they trusted. They said, okay, fine, go ahead and, you know, do whatever you want. Like, you know, whatever. Our money's gone. But I think, you know, what you want there is you want somebody who trusts you as against trusting the business plan. And that's what those guys did. Trust the team, not the business plan. That's a piece of paper. It's going to go into the trash anyway. If not in 2 days, in 20 days or 2 months or 3 months, sometime it's going to go to trash. So trust the team on that. And that's most important. So get a team which you can also trust and it's, you know, you're extremely passionate about and who is going to just stick with you while things kind of go down. So this was our end of phase one, where we had some money, we had moved to Bombay, and you know, we were trying to do something. Phase two, that started in as soon as we got the money. Money does good stuff. So, you know, we started to work on a new business plan, which was to do with like SMS deals. Now, I know there are tons of companies which do this well today, but we were an utter failure at that. Like, we just couldn't figure out how to make deals work on SMS. So we, instead of that, gave that up also. But this time, we gave it up in like 6 months, 5 to 6 months. Again, a classic case of, you know, realizing that we have made a mistake. We had two options. We could be emotionally stubborn about this, or we could have basically, we could just give it up and say it's not going to work. It took us 1 week to take this decision. And it's not an easy decision. We, you know, of the $500,000 that we had raised, 150 grand we had already pumped in. So to give it up at that point of time was not going to be easy, but we did. We said, again, we went to our angel investors. Now they were like, you know, all over the place. They were, so you're going to give up a second business model with our money. So you're testing with our money. We were very honest with it. Said, we can go ahead and do this, but we are quite confident that we won't be able to make it anything big. We're not going to make anything big out of this. So what's the point? Why should we do this? And why should you actually back us up on trying to do this? Because you're going to come every quarter, every month, attend board meetings and get bored with it. Because we're not going to do anything. It's not going to be big. We just couldn't see it becoming big. I'm sure people today are seeing it become big. So that's great. So we gave it up. But it was a critical decision for us. So we changed, you know, as the logo at the bottom is kind of signifying how we're changing through that phases. And then we said, look, the quest for us at any point of time was, we have to find something that's big. Because if you're not trying to find something that's big, then we are all wasting our time. We might as well go and do our jobs. Because at least, you know, you don't have to go through such agony if you go through that. But right now, we just wanted to make sure we're finding something big. So we felt that the whole mobile internet trend that we've been observing for the past 6 months while the SMS deals were failing seemed to make sense. It had some macro trend attached to it, which were exciting. So we kind of jumped into that. But it was not without people coming and telling us that, you know, you're morons to trying to do this. You have no idea that nobody's ever going to do anything with regards to internet on this small device. But guess what? That's why we are entrepreneurs. You don't listen to people. No. You've got to be bullhead. Believe in what you're going to do. And that's what we did. We said, thank you so much. We're going to still do what we want. And we did that. Because they had a firm belief onto something. Entrepreneurship is not about, you know, how well you're taking everybody's inputs into account. Entrepreneurship is about how confident are you about changing something. And when you're trying to change something, most of the people will.